September 11th workshop that we had jointly with the zoning board. Are there any questions or comments on the minutes of the two sets of minutes, actually, that we received here? No comments? Do I hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I was just waiting to see if anybody else would add anything. I think on page 4 of last meeting's minutes, there may be some things that need to be added or clarified. It regards the Zorsky-Thibodeau public access waiver approval with some of the conditions. Uh-huh. It was a difficult and confusing discussion, although I think in the end it made sense, but I think things were being added as amendments throughout, which made it a little difficult, I think, to include everything in. I don't know if the board members have had a chance that were there, have had a chance really to look at that. There's two examples that, two items that come out to my mind when I first read these were that under the first asterisk where Mr. Tinsman requested the following addition above, which was, and that the applicant shall obtain 350 feet of site distance to the west. I think at some point, either before Mr. Emery's addition or afterwards, I think I asked if that also should be, the item should be added, that site distance should also be measured to the east as well. I think there's general agreement, but again, I'm not sure. So that was one item I saw as a possible omission. I think under Mr. Emery's comment, where it says that advanced engineering submit a plan, I think it was just more in terms of the timing of the plan. And I think in addition to that, there was some discussion at some point about once the letter and the plan were submitted to Bob Hunter, then Bob Hunter would at the end also go out and review the actual site distance once all the removal of brush and ledge had been eliminated.
It seems like we are mostly concerned with the site distance to the west, but there certainly is reason to have it likewise noted to the east. The speed is different, though, isn't it, in that area?
The speed is different, and that's something that...
I guess it wouldn't be 350 to the east, would it?
That's the question.
Okay.
I think it could be, and that's what needed to be clarified. There was some discussion about having the sign moved, and we're in the process of actually having that done. But the question was, in terms of cars starting to speed up and starting to slow down, I think
lacking the moving of the sign, I think we have to be consistent with what exists on the site right now. And
that's,
I don't know. What is the recollection of the
Mr.
board?
Chairman, since it's probably my discussion, the interest and the concern was the 350 feet to the west. And as I recall, the site distance to the east was adequate, given the speed limit in that area, which was 25 miles an hour to the east, and it was 250 feet, and as I recall, it was adequate site distance to the east, and it wasn't the concern with that one. As I remember making the motion, and certainly it's subject to watching the tape or listening to the tape, that the primary concern was for the applicant to achieve the 350 feet to the west, as the minutes reflect.
What I would suggest then would be that, Steve, if you would just review the tape and see if that is the way it was actually done. If that's the case, then I'd say the minutes stand where they are. And I think in discussions with Mr. Zorsky, I think he has to understand that adequate site distance has to be demonstrated on both sides, and it has to be shown on the plan.
I think he's willing to do that. Okay. We just had some discussion about what would apply and whether or not, if not 350, then what site distance should be sought. So what I'll do is, I guess what I would recommend is that the board postpone voting on these minutes until I've had a chance to review and come back, and I can tell you what, you know, what was actually done at the meeting.
Well, I guess what we're looking for is a tabling of the approval of the minutes from our last meeting.
I'll second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor, signify by raising your hand. Opposed? Then we will table the minutes of our last meeting. What about the minutes of the planning workshop? Well, we don't really vote on those, I guess, as much.
Did we just get them tonight?
Yeah, I'd say, why don't we hold on those and let's treat them for informational purposes. I don't think, seeing it's not an official meeting as such, we'll let it go at that. Correspondence, a few items of correspondence that you have in front of you tonight. I'm not going to read them all because in the interest of time, we've had some notices of some courses from the Community Leadership Institute, and we have two public hearing notices from South Portland. I'm not going to bother reading them, but I will leave them here for the board to see after the meeting if you're interested. They are evidently on adjoining property with Cape Elizabeth, so they're for interest only. We also have a letter from T.Y. Lynn dated September 12th on the Zorsky Public Access Waiver, which Mr. Butler will go over with us at the end of the meeting tonight. Does that just about cover it? What about this, Steve?
That's a piece of correspondence.
Yeah.
And we'll be discussing later on.
Okay, well, we'll also be discussing a piece of correspondence dated September 14th regarding proposed amendments to the subdivision and zoning ordinances regarding application completeness. This is a discussion we will be having later on in our session as we start to talk about turning over some of this application completeness determinations to the planner. So we'll hold that piece of correspondence for later in the meeting. At this point in time, I'd like to move on to the first item in our agenda. It's a public hearing. Proposed amendments to the section 19-2-2-1 and 19-3-1B and 19-3-2B. Is this correct?
Actually, it's an L.
It's an L.
Typewriter.
19-2-2L is the first item of the Cape Elizabeth zoning ordinance regarding setbacks. This is a public hearing, so at this time I would like to open the public hearing. And before we actually receive any comments from the public on this item, I'd like to have a short review of the issues by our planner.
Okay. Thank you. At the last workshop with the planning board, there seemed to be a lot of unresolved issues to a point where I didn't think we'd even have an opportunity to really discuss some of the proposed changes. After talking in more detail with the code enforcement officer and the town attorney, it appears that the changes aren't as different as was originally portrayed. So I think we can at least have a discussion and the board at least consider making a recommendation to the town council to some degree. And I think that's what the town council is looking for. They're looking for a general response. But you can feel it's up to you to determine whether or not that's appropriate. There's really four major items and majors, an overstatement probably in terms of what's being proposed. The first change is to section 19-2-2L, which refers to adding decks to a provision of the ordinance that would then, instead of requiring decks now, if somebody wants to put a deck in many cases it has to be treated as a variance if it's close to certain setback requirements. Under this section, it would be able to be reviewed by the Board of Zoning Appeals under a much less stringent review process. And it's something that those of you that were at the workshop heard the zoning board mention that decks are a major problem. And they feel, at least, that it really doesn't have to be so. So they've just simply inserted decks into that section. The second major set of changes then refers, these all generally refer to setbacks, but the next section then bumps us over into section 19-3-1 and then related 19-3-2. What's being proposed, again, in response to some recent proposals before the zoning board, there's two major things that are being proposed. One is that rear additions be allowed to occur in such a way that they extend closer than currently allowed into the side and rear, side and front setbacks. The second item on page 28 of the handout then has a different section which relates to garages. The specific section refers only to non-conforming or existing lots of record. Two completely different sections. One of the changes that the staff are recommending to you and to the ordinance committee is that instead of having one section which applies to rear additions under 19-3-1, let me back up. These sections now are in two different sections as they're written. The proposal is to have them apply to both types of lots. Existing lots, as they stand now, if you, assuming your lots that you own are legal lots, that these reductions of setbacks should apply for rear additions and garages to all lots. Right now, they're separated, and they really shouldn't be. So, for example, on page 25, you see that the double asterisk, and there's the underlining. That really should be included at this point, and also on the next page, it should be added there. Conversely, on page 28 of the zoning ordinance, that section, in essence, should be duplicated and back to the previous page. That was really the major mix-up when this was first put together and initially reviewed by the ordinance committee. I'm going to stop there. Any questions? There's got to be.
Yeah, Steve, could you just review again the changes as it applies specifically to garages? I tried to read through that. I think I've got it. Could you just outline...
Okay.
I understand the deck proposal and
okay.
so forth, but other changes as it pertains to adding on, for instance, adding on to garages.
The idea is that if you don't have a garage and want to add one on, or if you have an existing one of some type and you want to extend it, that can be allowed and that the existing setbacks can be reduced by 50%. With the following conditions. One, that you're not going to replace a garage that was converted to a different use. Mm-hmm. For example, the garage that's been converted into a family room, the idea is you don't then get a bonus, so to speak, by then saying, well, at least now I need a garage. You had a garage, and it was your choice to replace it.
You can't add a garage to replace the family room that's now taking
right.
up that space.
And obtain the 50% reduction. I mean, you can if you have the requisite room on the side of your lot. In addition, it can't be an addition to an existing garage area. So if you don't have a garage, you can add it and extend in. But if there's any, if you have one bay garage, you want to get a two-car garage, this wouldn't apply. They also put a limit in terms of how big the garage can actually be. You can't go from, you know, if you had a situation where you were going from one car to a five car and you know, the fifth car space was going to extend in to that side setback, this would also probably not be allowed. I mean, there's a square footage requirement that was derived.
Mm-hmm.
And the other idea is then that if you have a garage constructed, existing or new, under this provision that does extend into the side setback, that then you won't be able to convert it to another. You then won't, down the road, be able to convert it into the family room or the rec room or what have you. And then that last condition, the proposal is to somehow tie that down with some sort of deed restriction so that that's part of the approval for that. That's in somebody's deed, so down the road they can't convert it, or at least if they do, the town has some right to call them on that. Okay. Any questions on?
So the criteria that you just mentioned, if we include one of the proposed amendments that it, that applies to both conforming and non-conforming lots, mm-hmm. those criteria also apply to both
right.
conforming and non.
Yep. And that's the idea. I mean, right now, this is something that the zoning board's been dealing with all types of lots. Mm-hmm. For some reason, it was put into this one section which deals with really substandard sized lots. I mean, lots that are below today's minimum lot size. And there's quite a few. You know. Minimum lot size in the residency district is 20,000 square feet. There are many lots around town that are underneath that. That would apply here. But there are also many lots that meet the current lot standards, and that's what page 25 refers to. The feeling is that both of these provisions should apply to both types of lots. Okay, any other questions on some of those?
Steve, I have a question on why putting in the deed restrictions. I just, more, I guess, in theory, why we see so much more of this.
I think part of it may be that if you don't do that, down the road, a few years, unless the paper trail is very good, and if there isn't much staff turnover, but if you don't have those really to the nth degree, it's perhaps easier for somebody, somebody who applied for this or two or three owners down, to come in and perhaps unknowingly convert a garage, for instance, into that family room, perhaps innocently. We want to have some, the idea is to have some way of letting people know that that's not something that you should do if you've triggered this process.
The only question I have, or the problem I have with it, is that I just think there are two, and just this is from what I see so often, is that when you put it into a deed restriction, it's an in perpetuity sort of thing. I mean, I deal daily with restrictions that were set forth innocently in the late 1800s, which are utterly absurd mm-hmm. today. They're meaningless, and you have to deal with them. I just think, I don't know, I guess there's a part of me that thinks that these zoning issues are within the venue and control of the zoning ordinance and the town and don't necessarily belong in the registry forever. And I mean, they are forever. There mm-hmm. will forever be that piece of property 200 years from now. You can't build in this particular piece of earth a family room. And yep. even though the changes may have, you know, the conforming, it could have acquired many more pieces of property around it, and it will no longer be valid, it's still, you can't build a family room in this footprint of earth.
I think it's a valid comment.
I'm not necessarily funny. It's just something I've just wondered about more recently.
Given your background, your work, is there some other way that it could be done? I mean, I guess it's still in the development process. We're looking for some way to let people know, and at least in the foreseeable future, not allow it to occur. But we don't also want to have something that becomes ridiculous a few years down the road.
I think perhaps if you had some time frame limit on it, I'm not sure. I don't know. You could limit it for 50 years. You could limit it for 100 years. But it's once those things are there, they certainly are seen in the process of doing the research on the land. But they take on an importance that is so much greater and has so much more weight than I think we really think we're giving to it.
I mean, any other comments on that? I think that's...
See, I think that's a good point, and that it's almost tougher to reverse that. Should the zoning ordinance change in 10 years, the number of... The paper trail of chasing back to those would be more difficult than the paper trail leading to discovery of those changes. I don't know how the code enforcement officer... Does he keep property card files, or is that part of the tax card? Is that something that could be tracked from a property card? I suppose the card, sorry, subdivide. I'm just trying to think of another way of keeping town record.
There are notes that are put on the property tax cards, as well as separate files that are kept on building permits that are taken out, which would be required for something like this. I mean, so there are ways to do it. I think it's just to make sure that, try to reduce the number of incidents where people come in and perhaps after the fact find out that they've done something they weren't, they shouldn't have done. But there may be other ways we can get around that, short of requiring something to be put in the deed. So, I mean, I think we'll take those comments and see what we can do.
Are there any comments from the public? This is a public hearing on this issue. Hearing none, then I would close this portion of the public hearing and ask once again if there are any further discussion items from the planning board.
One more item, sorry, Mr. Chairman. The one last change that's in here is back on page 25. And it's under the business front setback. And what's being proposed here is that those front setbacks be reduced. What these underlines, they're 50, 40, 30, depending upon the type of street. The current front setbacks are 100 feet for businesses on arterial roads, 100 feet for those on feeder streets, and then those on minor or private streets, it's 50 feet. What's being proposed is a reduction of that. And I this is something that we've seen again and again, especially at the zoning board level, where I think almost every single business that's come before the planning board for site plan review has first had to go to the zoning board to ask for a variance from the 100-foot setback requirement, which seems almost ludicrous. Most of the businesses we've been seeing, the building is within the 100-foot front setback. In fact, some of the lots could barely make that. And so it's, given the current level of development, 100 feet is definitely much too large.
Most of them are within the 50 feet, too.
Exactly. Right? Yeah. So there may even be a need to reduce it down from 50 feet. And that's something you can either, if you felt that that was the case, you could either come up with a specific recommendation, or barring that, since we haven't done a lot of research, you might at least, at a minimum, point out to the town council that's something that might need some further reduction down from even the 50 feet.
One question I would have on that, if I can jump in here, is the Main Street 90 program thought about what the Main Street would look like, for example, if some of the businesses that are there now cease to exist, and we had a chance to kind of relook at our main area. Would we look at setting those businesses back a significant distance from the road? I'm asking Mr. Tinsman maybe to respond since he's on the committee.
I'm not sure that there is a design vision for the future for out of the Main Street 90 committee. There is a desire to have a town center that looks like a town center. There's been a lot of work and effort over the last month, particularly in a concentrated basis by the subcommittee, town center subcommittee, to meet with the businesses and most recently about 2 days ago with the shopping center owners to take what we have and try to make it into more of a town center. That would envision businesses being much closer than the 100 feet. In a village or a town center, you don't have businesses spread far back from its main street. So in that regard, the 100 feet is for at least the town center area, which is defined as the Tarbox Triangle to the Fowler Road area. The 100 feet is clearly too much. For other business areas, wherever they might exist and however they might be constituted, the 100 feet might make some sense in some cases. Now, many of you remember that when we did the farm stands revisions to the ordinance, we tracked the business setback distances, particularly for that kind of business, as it located in amongst residential uses. So in that context, the 100 feet may make some sense, but in the town center, it certainly would not. So distinguishing town center from other areas, I think, would be appropriate.
Okay. Any other comments? Are we ready to take a vote on this issue?
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
My only question or comment has to do with what exactly are we sending to the town council? Is this in the form of suggestions? I guess I'm a little unclear. We're proposing to send or proposing to reducing the 50-foot as one amendment, I should say, without being specific. I mean, are they looking for that much directive from us?
Steve, maybe.
Or are we just making suggestions to the town council?
Usually, what the planning board does is they make very specific recommendations to the town council. Oftentimes, you're recommending ordinance provisions that you've actually developed and are passing on. In this case, that's not the situation. So I think, if anything, this is maybe less specific than what you normally see. The question is going to be what your comfort level is in terms of what you feel should be passed on. Talking to the ordinance committee chairperson, the general feeling, though, was that the town council was looking for, or the ordinance committee at least, was looking for general feedback to what was proposed in whatever manner. Okay, because they realized that they're doing additional work as you were. So it wasn't a final product, which is often the case, but they wanted to get something out, get some feedback from you, and keep on going with their development process.
I guess my question would be, is we've had a public hearing on this, and would it be something that we send along to them as our sense of what we want to do with this, or do we actually, I guess, vote on these amendments? If we vote on the amendments, then I would assume that's something that the ordinance committee has to act on at this point in time.
Well, it's a recommendation, so they would act on those recommendations as they saw fit.
Yeah. So that's what we're sending along to the council is our recommendations on these two items of this ordinance. I guess with that in mind, do I hear a motion on this issue?
Anticipating some additions that might be being written right now. Be it ordered that the Planning Board recommends to the Town Council the proposed amendments to Sections 19.2.2L, 19.3.1B, and 19.3.2B of the Zoning Ordinance relating to setbacks in accordance with Section 19.4.9 of the Zoning Ordinance, subject to the following general revisions. That the provisions regarding rear additions in a garage apply to both conforming lots, sections 19.2.2L, and lots of record, section 19.3.2B, and that the Town Council consider reducing the 50 feet front setback for lots with arterial street frontage within the business A, B, and C districts in order to reduce the likelihood of these lots needing to request a variance from the Board of Zoning Appeals.
Is that the correct wording for that, or is it reduced to 50 feet? Steve, I think that reduced to 50 feet, or is it reduced the 50 feet?
You know, reducing down from what's being proposed is now 50 feet. The idea might be to reduce it down even further.
Oh, right, reduce down.
That was what my question is.
Okay,
the discussion we're reducing it, reducing the 50 foot, but to what level? And I guess we're just giving sort of general directive to the council saying this is what we're suggesting. Perhaps there will be another amendment come up shortly that might clarify that even more.
Okay. Do we have another amendment to this motion?
I'm going to amend it for the deed restriction portion. The deed restrictions be required inserted only after the approval of the town attorney.
Okay, would that be an amendment to item A or an additional item C?
I think it would be an amendment to item A.
Amendment to item A, okay. So item A would now read how?
Well, it's actually amending one of the sections.
I think it probably would be a third proposal. Perhaps would you just state that that it'd be section 19-3-2B sub 6D. Right, and that that last section be amended as, and then if you could just state your language again.
Could you read it for me?
It says, will not be converted to any other use that's proposed to be added by deed.
What does it say? That deed restrictions will be?
It doesn't get to that level at this point. It's just a proposed staff change. It says, you know, it's part of that larger sentence that states that except the side setback, blah, 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 may be reduced by 50%, providing the following criteria are met, 1, 2, 3, then 4, will not, so it'd be referring to the side setback, that will not be converted to any other use. And the language that's right there now is by deed, but that's would have to be worked out. That just grammatically doesn't make sense.
I'm not sure. Do I have to make it?
Mr. Chairman, if I might, and I'm not sure whether this does it, but it almost sounds like this is a Washington hearing with B's and C's and E's and subsections. And why don't we just talk about the basic document, which is to remove the deed restriction, which I think we're all in agreed should not be in there. And then use that as a basis of the document for the motion that Mr. Edstall makes, which is to pass it on to the council with recommendations for adoption, rather than looking for an amendment to the motion, which amends a document that may or may not get amended before
anyways,
it gets
right. Exactly. So are we clear on it now?
Just get the deed stuff out and let's vote.
Okay. So just so it's clear to me, then, that the subject to the following general provisions, A and B, is being proposed to be removed and substituted with Ms. Kane's language that the deed restriction language be
omitted.
Omitted. Yeah.
But that's not a part of the motion. That's just.
Oh, it's just the general.
Take it out of the document.
Okay, so.
But we're not taking out the general provisions A and B.
No.
Okay.
Those stay in.
But to drop the provision for deed restrictions. Mm-hmm. Deed restrictions.
Right. Governments and deeds.
Okay.
Which was going to be an additional item, which is now not added. Now, not going to be there. So I guess the amendment, or I should say the motion stands as read. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor, signify by raising your hand. Opposed? Passes on to the town council, and that finishes that item. We're now at our second item in our agenda, Spurwick Woods. Is there a representative from Spurwick Woods here tonight?
Oops.
And I guess the answer was no. I guess
no. We
encourage them not to come. What we have received in our package, or you should have in your package, is a request on the part of Spurwick Woods that we table their application at this time and continue it on to the October, to November, it's been changed, to the November 1990 Planning Board session.
So moved.
Any second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Passes unanimously. So that's on till November. Next item is Stonegate, same situation. Continuance once again to the November meeting. Any questions on this? So moved. Second? Any discussion on this one? All those in favor? opposed? We moved right up. Okay, we're right on time. Amazing how we do that, isn't it? Okay.
It's amazing what you can do under pressure, isn't it?
Yes. Moving right along. Is there a representative from the Viking Intermediate Care Facility present? Next item on our agenda. Construction of a 60-bed addition to the existing facility, Scott Dyer Road, site plan review, section 19-29, 19-315 of our ordinances. Would you please identify yourself, sir?
Yes, I'm Dwayne Rancourt, and I'm the administrator of the Viking Nursing Home as well as a principal of the Viking Nursing Facility and Jupiter 9 Trust. I have no formal presentation to the board this evening. I'm up here to sort of occupy some time and maybe give some history while the technocrats of our team are getting prepared to make their presentation. The Viking Nursing Home came before the planning board back in 1978 to construct a 60-bed nursing facility on Scott Dyer Road. We were successful then. We have been in operation since November of 1979. We've been excited, thrilled to be here in Cape Elizabeth. We've looked at our industry. We've seen our industry changing. We know that the over 85 group is going to expand to by 60% in the next 10 years. We need to prepare for that. We want to get ready for the next century that's coming up, and we feel that what we're going to be presenting to you this evening for an expansion, a 60-bed addition to the nursing home, will meet the needs not only of Cape Elizabeth and the long-term care needs of the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, but also those people in our surrounding towns of South Portland and Scarborough. I have with me this evening my partner, Ron Boutet, who may or may not be called upon. It has to be moved this way. Can't we just move it? The gentleman who's moving the easel is Kent Coffin. Kent is from Kentech, who has prepared for us our feasibility study and has worked with the town planner, Steve Butler. Our landscape architect is here also. His name is Steve Kurtz, Stephen Kurutz, and Stephen will be participating in the presentation. I'll turn it over to Kent now for his presentation. Kent?
Just so we remember what we're here for, this is a completeness review on this application, so if you would address yourself to the elements of your application, and we will be asking our planner to comment on the completeness of it.
After what are you asking me for? I didn't hear what you said, sir.
This is a completeness review session, so we'd be interested in what the elements of your application are. We'll be asking our planner to comment on the completeness of this application when you get finished.
Basically, you have the application in front of you. There's a project description. It goes through the different sections of site plan review submission requirements, housing for the elderly and standards. Under each section, there's another cross-reference on where to look in the attachments. There's attachments A through M. Attachments A through G are site layout plans, soils, grading and drainage, and lighting and planting, respectively. Attachment H is a soils narrative. Survey plans are attached. Property owners are attached. Attachment K, utilities, we have a bit of a snafu here. Unfortunately, I was in court this afternoon when Stephen called me and asked me to try to find a water district letter. I have that in my files. I just didn't have the time today to pull it together. I had to go to court. I'm sorry. There's also a community impact analysis and a market feasibility study. There's one other item that I believe you have. It's addressed in a cover letter. That's the concept of several land transfers with the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. The status of those transfers is that we are undergoing revisions to the purchase and sales agreement. I think we've been through four different revisions at this point. We have no problem with the revisions at all. We're changing whatever is asked of us. As soon as
it's ascertained that the land trust is willing to accept the documents in the form that they want, that given them, they will be signed, and I expect that at this point, they will be signed next week. One of the things, you have a plan, a small plan, which shows that the patterns of the land that we now own. The Viking Nursing Home is currently 14 acres with the lands around it. We will be giving away 3.96 acres upon approval. This is land that we no longer want nor need. We also have another piece of land, 5.9 acres in dimension, that we are using as part of our density, but once we get the density, we're going to give the Viking, we're going to give that land to the Land Commission also. That will enable them, what you see, the bold black outline will be the Viking Nursing Home. So that's a total of 3.96, 10 acres. We will have 5 acres on the Viking Nursing Home, and we'll be giving away the balance of the land. We don't need it, we don't want it, and I think the town has a much better use for it than we do. Trying to think. I think that the application for site plan review is for six, is you have the original booklet was for 54 beds. Since that time, we have modified our plans and our calculations, and we are now asking for 60 beds for site plan review. That's basically what I have to say. I think that the document stands for itself.
Thanks.
You need 60?
Okay.
Okay. Mr. Bartle, could you comment on the application and its completeness and the major issue that's outstanding at this point?
Sure. As you can see from the checklist, the application is relatively complete. Just going down, there's actually, those of you who had a chance to, all of you had the chance to read the letter from T.Y. Lynn, the town's engineer, regarding some items that Robert Hunter felt should be added, some of which relate to completeness. And so there's some areas where I put okay, where Mr. Hunter felt there might be some additional items, and I would have to agree with him on one or two of them. So going down the checklist, everything on page 1 appears to be in order. Going to page 2 then, 8A is a relatively minor item. It talks about showing all existing physical features on the site and within 200 feet thereof. They fall a little short of the 200 feet outside of the site, but they do a good job of showing the site conditions within the site. So I think that's a relatively minor one. I just wanted to bring that forward to the board. On number 10, parking, loading, and unloading area locations and information, that's one where the town engineer feels that there's more information needed in terms of the actual geometrics, the design of the parking areas, the road entrances, things of this nature. So that's probably something that should be marked partial and something which the applicant has said they would provide but haven't up to this point.
Mr. Chairman, does the applicant have a copy of T.Y. Lynn's letter before them right now?
I don't have one before me right now. I received one on Monday. It was faxed over to me last week.
We sent out.
Right. And I received the hard copy this week. Last week. I'm getting my weeks confused.
Okay. Just to clarify for those of you who read Bob Hunter's comments and had some questions, 12A is okay. In Bob Hunter's review letter, he had some questions as to what was there. The supplemental letter shows that it was materials that he didn't have in his file regarding stormwater. It's a very complete stormwater management plan that was sent over to him, and he felt that was adequate. Item 12C is marked okay, given what Mr. Coffin mentioned. It should be marked as partial. Again, it's something that I thought I remembered seeing in terms of a letter from the Portland Water District, something Mr. Coffin thought was available, but we don't have copies of it. So
I will bring it to you tomorrow.
We assume it's there. It's a relatively minor point. Item 14, lighting details, again, minor, something that Bob Hunter also pointed out, but it's partial in terms of showing where the actual lighting footprint would go. There is some information that has been provided, but it doesn't go into detail in terms of showing exactly what the on-site and off-site impacts might be. Really, the major item that's outstanding, other than the letter from the Portland Water District, is the last one, which deals with evidence of right, title, or interest in the property, and that refers, and that would regard the signed agreements between the applicants and the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, which really are crucial to ascertaining what the density, what the actual site is that's being proposed for development, and what the density is that would be allowed for the proposal. If the transfers weren't done to the land trust, it would alter, perhaps drastically, the number of beds that the Viking nursing home could actually achieve. So that's something that sounds like it's in the final stages of negotiation, should be signed momentarily. We have representatives from the land trust, and but still, at this point, something that needs to be done before completeness probably could be found.
We do have a representative from the land trust, Dr. Rand. Would you care to comment on this application?
Simply to corroborate what Mr. Coffin said, he has provided me in the last week with a copy of two purchase and sale agreements, one for two parcels, one to the east of Viking Nursing Home, one to the south of it, and then that's in one purchase and sale agreement. The third is applies to a parcel to the west. And I've been in discussion with him, as he stated. We've made some minor changes. And as I've called a meeting of the Land Trust for a week from tomorrow night to consider signing the purchase and sale agreements. And at this point, I myself don't see any problems, but it'll be up to the board to make that decision.
And that'll happen next week?
Wednesday night.
Wednesday night. Okay. Thank you, sir. And with that transfer complete, the density will be satisfied in this?
That is correct.
That is correct. And you'll be able to demonstrate that, I assume?
Yes.
In your documents. Are there any questions from the board on this application? No, we're considering completeness issues only at this point in time.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make my standard plea and comment on application completeness. That to me, as one board member, when an applicant submits data, whether it's right or wrong, inappropriate or not, as long as it meets the test of data being submitted, then that's an application completeness. At the point of technical review, this board then determines whether or not the data is appropriate for approval or appropriate for disapproval. And it's a fine line that we walk between determining application completeness and determining that everything's copacetic and fine for approval. I think some of the items that Steve was talking about for application completeness are technical review items, the engineer's reports. We'll be getting into those as we determine through the substantive discussion of the technical merits of the application, whether or not what they proposed is appropriate or not. I guess the question that I would ask Steve is whether or not there's anything missing and or not submitted for application completeness review.
Okay. Clearly, there aren't the design geometrics for the parking lot, some of the driveway entrances, things of this nature. There also isn't in our files at this point, in your hands, a letter from the Portland Water District. So those are clear omissions. We always have this discussion. Right title of interest, we have something. Again, I think without the signatures, in my view, it would be an omission, but that's up to interpretation. But we have at least two areas where information isn't complete, hasn't been submitted.
Mr. Chairman, if I might, and other board members may want to see it differently, there is a parking lot proposed. It may not be fully dimensioned as may be required, and we may require additional data to determine the geometrics, but there is data submitted. On the right title and interest, something has been submitted. Whether it's appropriate or not is for us then to determine whether it is or not. And the issue of, what was the last thing, Steve? Of the
water supply.
Water supply. That's a letter from Portland Water District that they are bound by the Public Utilities Commission to supply water to facilities and businesses within the region, and that's really a perfunctory or a pro forma letter that they have to give to the businesses unless there's a serious capacity problem. And I'm sure that Portland Water District will assure us, even with high water on Sebago Lake, that there is no capacity problem for serving Viking Nursing Home. So, Mr. Chairman, as one board member, I really don't see anything that it would hold us up from application completeness this evening.
Thank you, Mr. Tinsman. One point that we should make on this, normally if we did vote that this was complete, we would schedule a site walk, which I don't think we've had really for this area. We've been over to the Viking for a number of other reasons, but I don't think we really reviewed the site. And then schedule a public hearing on the preliminary plan review. So that would be the steps that we would go through at this point in time. Any other comments on the completeness of this application?
Mr. Chairman, just one question or comment, and I don't know if it's out of line or whether it's within our jurisdiction. Under subdivision plan review application, we deal with financial capability. I guess I'm posing the question to the planner and the rest of the board whether it's reasonable for us to request, because of the magnitude of this project, it's not the written requirement in here. Is it reasonable for us to request it? Is it even within our jurisdiction to request it? Or is it simply prudent planning procedure to request some type of financial capability statement?
You're talking about a financial capability statement from the applicant.
Mr. Chairman, in response, there's no specific requirement in the site plan review standards that requires the applicant to provide a financial or technical capacity, technical or financial capacity information. However, there's a provision in the site plan review standards that allows that the board may request evaluation of specific aspects of the site plan and that it may request additional information or evaluation. Now, whether or not that's something that, you know, whether or not financial capacity is something you'd want to ask for under that provision, I don't know. Maybe something that the applicant's willing to provide regardless. I don't know.
If I may. There is a comment from the audience.
Yes, sir.
Could you come up and identify yourself, please?
Yes, Ronald Boutad, a principal of Viking. In regard to this, no, we would not have a problem providing this. We're dealing with a company called Related Mortgage Company that deals with the HUD 232 program. And one of the things, and we have submitted all of our applications and have been given preliminary approval. The problem with from related, they take the first two steps with the HUD application. One of the problems you have to have to go on to these is planning board approval for the expansion. So that is the limitation. But as far as the actual financial feasibility, that's been given to them, and they have, in fact, accepted it. They're working with us on the application.
Mm-hmm. And you would have no problem submitting that as part of this application?
Not what's
Which HUD program did you say was?
232.
I would suggest that since the applicant's willing and being a little bit familiar with the municipality's involvement in that program, it would be prudent that we include that,
if I may,
in our request.
I hope that would not be part of the determination of completeness, however.
I certainly wouldn't want to hold this process up.
It would become additional information for the package.
Part of the problem is once we get into this step, then we can move steps. The steps seem to go forward at the same time. We're running parallel ladders at this point. I guess parallel tracks.
I'm just saying, let's put it on the ladder
and
right now.
And that will keep you abreast of everything that happens.
Any other comments from the board on this point of application? I have one question. It seems like in our earlier discussions when you were before us quite a few months ago, there was a discussion of a sidewalk along Scott Dyer Road.
Okay. We are more than willing.
What's the status of that?
The sidewalk, on the plans in front of you, on the site plan, I believe you will see a sidewalk stretching from the Viking all the way to the...
I assume as part of the technical review, differentiating, as Mr. Tinsman has told, has warned us from completeness review, as part of the technical review, Public Works would take a look at this installation and,
yes.
And review it.
They've initially done that. They'll do more detailed work. And I think in the materials, it stated that the sidewalk to be built along Scott Dyer Road will be constructed by the owners of the Viking under the supervision of the town.
Good. Okay.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
I would like to make a motion.
Sure.
And with the preparatory remarks that there are times when the planning board will ask for more data during the substantive review of the technical parts of the application. The applicant has to understand that, and I think they do. And with that, I would move that we be it ordered that the site plan review application for a 60-bed addition to the existing Viking Intermediate Care Facility located at 126 Scott Dyer Road and proposed by the Jupiter 9 Trust is deemed to be complete in accordance with Section 19.29 of the Zoning Ordinance and the facts presented.
Is there a second? Any discussion? All those in favor? Raise your hand. Opposed? We have unanimous application complete. At this point in time, I'd like to schedule a sidewalk, if that's possible, sometime before our next meeting, obviously. And we will schedule that in the hearing. Let's see. We're running out of daylight at the end of the day, unfortunately, now, so I don't know whether we want to switch to a Saturday review sidewalk or try to still stick with an end of the day sidewalk. It's not a large site. We could do it at the end of the day, I guess, and get it in.
Mr. Chairman, just maybe to help, we may need to either do one weekend or two evening or two late afternoon sessions since we're assuming we're probably going to, the board will probably want to also schedule a site walk for the Monk site.
Yeah.
Again, relatively, the site walk should be relatively short.
Well, unfortunately, the next two Saturdays are out for me. The next three Saturdays are out for me, so I'm not going to be too good for Saturdays.
How about the 13th?
Pardon?
I think the 13th is probably the first time we're...
The 13th?
Saturday the 13th of October.
Is that running it too close to the meeting date?
It would be the Saturday before
the meeting
day.
Is that a problem?
No.
Do we want to try for that? It's October 13th.
Mm-hmm.
It's fine with us.
Is that okay?
If you want to make changes, though, it might be a little tight between.
That's where I'm a little concerned about. Chances are that won't be a factor here, because we're basically taking your application as complete now. We'll be looking at it, that application and taking the sidewalk. Yeah. When we get into the technical review part, then there might be some changes.
That's fine then. I have no problem.
So we'll hit you first. What about say 10 o'clock? Saturday morning?
That's first,
yeah. It's Saturday. It's not Friday morning. It's Saturday morning.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Yes. 10 o'clock, right. Okay. Viking sidewalk. And I assume we can just pull right in the driveway there.
Yes, we will be there.
Right. Thank you. We'll see you.
Yes. I was wondering if at the sidewalk, and then I don't want to make the applicant jump through a lot of hoops, but I mean, one of one of my concerns, I think it's going to be concerned with a number of people, is the size and magnitude of the building. Is there any way to, and I'm just thinking about past block where we went to another site right near yours, where it's a little hard to envision the same size building, whether you put the 16-foot two or four in each front corner, just so there's some sense of where's the front of the building going to be, mm-hmm. perhaps what's the height of the peak of the roof right there.
We will do something.
You know,
we can take care of that.
Hour, take it down yep. 20 minutes.
Maybe
so
balloons.
Sure.
Maybe balloons would be a simple.
Well, as long as it's not a windy day.
We did have a windy day to wrap this high off the ground.
Yes, and stake it out so we can have an idea where the building's going to be.
Okay.
Appreciate it.
Yeah. I'll do that.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
We're early for our next item on our agenda, so I might ask are there representatives of Robert and Millicent Monks here for the application on placement of a single family residence? Are those people here? Do you mind going earlier, or would you like us to take a 5-10 minute break for you to assemble your troops?
I would just sort of take a 5-10 minute break.
We'll take a 10 minute recess. We'll be back at 8:10.
Mr. Chairman, do you want to...
Request for Wetlands Protection Special Permit Sections 19-2-8 and 19-3-9. If you would be so kind as to identify yourself and your team members and give us a short 5 to 7 minute presentation on this application, we appreciate it.
Okay. My name is Tom Riddle. I'm a representative of Robert and Millicent Monks. I brought with me Al Frick and Rich Light, and Al Frick is Al Frick Associates, and Rich Light is Land Use Consultants. They've been helping me compile the data for the application for a wetlands permit. What we are seeking to do, as you stated, is build a single-family residence on Dollar Beach Road. The property is owned by the Sprague Corporation, and it's allocated to Millicent Monks under her ownership. What we brought is a map also of the outlined area, showing the upland edge, the critical wetland edge, and the 250-foot buffer. What I'd like to do is just to answer any questions you may have regarding this application.
Are there any questions from the board at this point on this application?
Yes.
No.
Okay. I get a bunch.
Sure.
You presented a fairly complete application for a single family home, probably as much data as we usually get for a 20 lot subdivision. And we usually take several months for the subdivision. Presumably we won't for a single family home. A couple of questions though relative to the placement of the building on the site. Some of the design aspects of the property and some of the questions that the engineers have had, and the relationship to this from this property to a parcel of land that's just been purchased by a group, including the land trust, residents of the town of Cape Elizabeth, immediately adjacent to the proposed house. First, the site issues. You have a driveway coming in off another driveway, and your application was very complete, but I didn't see any agreement with the property owner, and maybe it was there and I just missed it. I think that's Dave Pickering's driveway.
That's correct, yeah.
And it's a previously approved subdivision from the town called Ottawa Springs. Could you tell us what kind of relationship there is between the Ottawa Springs development, Mr. Pickering, and this application?
What we have done is Dave Pickering has agreed to let us build the driveway off of his existing driveway. He's given us, I have brought with me tonight a tentative agreement as far as it hinges on whether we get the wetlands permit or not. What our original easement across between the Hagmans and the Powells gave us no provision for upgrades or to put utilities across, and it was getting it got a little bit complicated because they weren't really pleased to have the easement between their two houses used for another driveway. So to avoid any litigation or on their part, that we decided that I went to Dave Pickering, asked him if he'd be willing to give us an easement across his parcel. He agreed to do that so we could have access for utilities, upgrade it, put a residential driveway in.
Okay. Second question is, where is the existing right-of-way, pedestrian right-of-way that has been discussed for access to the piece of land that was just purchased by the land trust?
This is the existing pedestrian easement there. We have no real control over the pedestrian easement. The pedestrian easement would remain in the same spot. what we are proposing to do is build our driveway in the different spot.
Okay, I see the pedestrian easement off to the right-hand side of the map.
Mm-hmm.
Where does it go through, or does it abut this property?
What it used to do, I mean, the easement is really vague. It has never been clearly defined. Most of the people now have used the existing woods road, and then there's a pretty makeshift path mm-hmm. through the woods mm-hmm. is what the pedestrian easement is today. It's from the Sprague Corporation standpoint, it has never been clearly defined.
Would it be worthwhile defining that easement, and maybe even, for a couple of reasons? One is that presumably there will be more people using this pedestrian right-of-way to a land parcel that's been purchased specifically for their use. And I would be concerned about the house having people wandering up and asking where this land is. And it may be appropriate to define, mark, or otherwise indicate somehow where people should be going to the land.
Yes, after we had, in the discussions we've had concerning this parcel, that has come up over and over again with the Spread Corporation and Mrs. Munzer. And what we have intended to do is clearly mark where the easement is, and we intend to do that this winter.
Can you tell us where you intend to clearly mark it?
What we were hoping to do is keep the remaining easement down the woods road that we have, and then the path generally cuts down across the front. And that's what we would do. We were planning to mulch the trail and make it clearly define it along the shore.
So you intend to not only mark the trail, but mulch it and encourage people to stay on
the trail.
The trail. It's a good idea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman.
And this will go near the land that's being purchased by the land trust.
It'll go right onto the land.
Onto the land.
Mr. Chairman, this tonight, as I understand the process, is an application completeness, an application for completeness. Presumably, the planning board tonight will be voting that it's a complete application or an incomplete application. If it's a complete application, then we are required to have a public hearing on this for as
well. Well, I think we should have a sidewalk, and then I don't think we're required to have a public hearing, are we?
Yeah,
we're
required to have a public hearing within 35 days, and that's at the next meeting.
So we are required on this one.
So there will be another time when we're back on this application. It's something that will be continued to next month with some definitive goals and all of that.
Correct.
Mr. Chairman, if we could request the applicant to show on his site plan that the planning board will be approving where that pedestrian access should, could, and will be located on the ground, that would be very useful, I think, for this applicant so there's no dispute in the future and for the town to know where that is.
That request is made. Also, if you could note that on our sidewalk,
Okay.
It'd be very handy for us to be able to see that during the site walk, too.
Very good.
So we know where that is.
Yeah.
Good. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, last question I have, I think, relative to T.Y. Lynn's letter in the second paragraph, which presumably the applicant has had a copy of, dated 12 September. And his second paragraph, Bob Hunter's second paragraph, says, I would only comment that the proposed location of the septic tank is not indicated. It may be desirable to locate the system element and location. Now, the chamber system is there, the leach field chamber system, whatever it's called. But apparently, the septic tank is not located on there, and he says that would be good to do. I mean, I saw a system there, but I didn't really look at whether it was chamber or septic.
Has the applicant had a chance to first of all, see this letter and...
No, I have not.
You have not. Can you comment on the location of the septic tank?
And could you comment on that, Al?
Yeah, we submitted a completed HNG 200 form, a subsurface wastewater disposal application that shows the exact location on documents submitted in the application. The septic tank would be placed between the proposed residence and the chamber area shown right here, and the residence would be here.
Okay. Steve, maybe you could review that with Bob Hunter and see where his problem was with that location.
Yeah, I don't see the, I don't remember seeing the HHE 200s. Yeah. It could be there, but.
We have an expert on the board on HHE 200s.
I knew that comment would come this way then.
All three sheets, right?
I didn't see any of the sheets of the HHE 200 on here. That would show where the tank would be located.
I guess we would be looking for that as part of the application.
And I think that would be important. The engineer's request, we can assume where it might be, but his comment is also, I think, access to the tank is important.
And that may be in the context of technical data, again, application completeness for wetlands alteration doesn't necessarily require HHE 200 forms. Chairman, also, who prepared the application completeness form? It looked so perfect that it looked like an applicant's submission.
The town planner has to take credit for that.
Compliment is so noted. Any other questions on the completeness of this application at this point in time?
I feel that it's as complete as it's going to be. There are a few questions, and I have several questions of technical things, which I feel should be addressed later. I would make a motion.
Fine.
Could it be accepted?
Fine.
Be it ordered that the Planning Board recommends to the Town Council, be it ordered that the application of Robert Millicent Monks for a wetlands protection special permit for placement of a single-family residence and construction of a driveway and subsurface disposal system on a lot located off Bowery Beach Road, Map R6, Lot 29, is deemed to be complete in accordance with Section 19-3-9 of the Zoning Ordinance and the facts presented. Be it further ordered that the Planning Board will conduct a public hearing on this application at its October 16, 1990 meeting.
Second.
Any further discussion?
I just have an editorial comment on our new wetlands alteration. I take it's part of the new. I noticed that the numbers of copies gone from 15 copies to 23 copies. And I understand that is for the benefit of the conservation members. I find it odd that in the sake of conservation, we're adding stacks of paper. I hope that the town is considering using recycled paper in its copying efforts. That's my comment.
So noted.
So noted.
If that's a proposed ordinance change, no. Sure.
I Hearing no further discussion on the issue at hand, all those in favor, signify by raising their hand. Opposed? The application is deemed to be complete. A hearing is set for our October meeting, and we would like to also schedule a site walk. And the suggestion was made earlier that we combine it with another site walk. It's occurring on October 13th. That's an acceptable time. We have an early session at 10 o'clock, so I would suggest this be our later one.
No, let's not make it late.
At 11 o'clock?
Can we do the other one in an hour?
Is that all right?
You think so?
Yeah.
Well, we have a long ride over there, so. So would you like to make it sooner than that?
No, I just thought...
I think an hour is a minimum time.
Well, I just thought it would take longer than an hour.
Oh, longer than an hour.
At the Viking.
With a refreshment.
Wow, are you bringing the donuts?
Is anybody else concerned? Good.
No, I would think that an hour or 45 minutes at Viking is sufficient. I mean, we're going to be standing there next to a...
bunch of 2x4s.
Building, yeah, and balloons.
Is 11 o'clock on the 13th acceptable?
Yes.
Okay, what about for the applicant?
That's fine.
Is that fine? Where do you want us to park?
I would think the best, if there's no objection with the owners, I think probably the dairy bar would be the best spot to park, where we haven't, where the easement with Dave Pickering is still.
Well, I don't know if it's still open in October, but if it is, we're going to have a bunch of cars sitting in their parking lot.
There's no road to the property.
There's no road to the property?
Not for a car.
Well, why don't we do this?
Is there any room on the side of Dave Pickering's driveway?
I think there is. I'll talk to Dave and make
would
sure.
Would you, seeing that we have some time between now and the 13th, would you determine where an acceptable parking place will be for about 6 cars?
Mm-hmm.
And then transmit that information to Mr. Butler, and he'll get it into the notice for the sidewalk.
Very
instructing
good.
Us where to park.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, just one question for the board. The applicants have some of their wetlands experts and the like here. Are there any questions that the board might have of some of those experts now rather than at the next meeting? Not that the applicants necessarily prevented from having them come to the next meeting, but since they're here, is there any questions that the board might have at this point?
Mr. Chairman, I've got one that relates to the septic system, and depending, and I'm sure the HHE 200s and all of that show that it's an acceptable site or the system wouldn't have been located there. But I'm wondering about impact analysis on a critical wetland area or defined critical wetland area and whether or not there's any impact analysis that's occurred from a single family home's impact on the critical wetland.
Would one of the people present care to answer that question?
My name is Betsy Day. I'm a Normando associate. Mm-hmm. Did the wetland delineation and assessment work. And I think our point is that the critical wetland zone is separated from the development site by the wetland protection zone, by quite a wide wetland protection zone, which, of course, is also wetland. But it's the more of the type of wetland that functions well as a water quality protection type of area.
Mm-hmm. Could you point those areas out on the map to your left, probably?
Okay. Right. This would be the critical wetland zone here, and the wetland protection zone is the much larger area. There's quite a distance. There's also an upland between the critical wetland zone and this area. However, over here, it goes right to the critical wetland zone, but there's...
What goes right to the critical?
There is no buffer area constituting a wetland protection zone between the septic system and the critical wetland zone right in this area, but there's quite a distance of upland that also serves that water quality protection and filtering function. So I feel that the distance between those areas is quite sufficient there's not going to be, I mean, presuming, and I am not a septic system engineer, presuming that it's correctly engineered, there is a good distance between the critical wetland zone as it comes closest to that area. Whereas over on this side, there's a nice buffer of the wetland protection zone between the critical area. Now, the critical area being, of course, the wetter and more obligate species of wetlands.
You may not be a septic engineer, but you have a reputation for being one of the best ecological scientists, so you shouldn't apologize for not being a septic system engineer. Could you describe the landform between the edge of the Great Pond and the proposed septic system in a direct line?
The upland portion?
Yes.
Well, I didn't direct my efforts really at the uplands, but I believe it's mostly an oak woodland with in some areas an understory of herbaceous understory of ferns, a fairly open understory of shrubs, but very well vegetated, naturally vegetated.
So it's upland all the way to the edge of the pond.
Right. There's quite a slope right on the very edge here, about the most definite wetland boundary I've seen in a long time. And then it goes down to, oh, there's a lot of dead maples, and then surrounded by cattails and what's called manna grass, a lot of wetland grasses and wetland
How far away is that from the septic system?
199 feet.
Thank you.
What are the areas of wetland disturbance from the driveway that were cited in the application?
It's a very, very narrow zone right in here that is probably a man-made ditch, just a swale, not even a ditch. And it's vegetated with arrowwood, which is a wetland, a marginal wetland shrub. It's not a very valuable area in my mind. Like I said, it's very, very narrow, about 20, 30 feet wide.
Professional opinion, impact from septic system on wetlands?
The impact of the septic system on wetlands is back over here again. I think, I feel that given the distance and the proper design of it, that I don't anticipate any impacts to that wetland. I feel the distance is quite good, and the land in between is currently undisturbed, and I know of no plans to disturb this area in between, so it will maintain its filtering properties.
Okay. Would you determine that by doing any background analysis of the water quality in that area, and then providing some afterwards? Would that be practical, or is this just too small a source to do anything like that?
It certainly could be done. Are you asking if...
I mean, I'm just asking, in your position, is it practical for this kind of a source?
It seems like if the... the system was right on the edge.
Mm-hmm.
I think that would be a prudent thing to do. But given that it's that, given the distance that it is from the wetlands, I can't imagine that you'd see an impact from it.
Okay, just curious.
If I could just make one quick comment again, Rick Light from Land Use, that on that.
Could you step up to the microphone? Sorry about
that. Not being a hydrogeologist.
Could you identify yourself, sir, please?
Rick Light from Land Use Consultants, I'm sorry. Just something to add to the salt on that issue there that comes up time and time again. The separation distance, we found on similar sites that we have, say, larger subdivisions where we've had, say, gravel or a sandy soil, and an assessment has been done of the impacts of nitrates in fecal coliform, et cetera, on wetlands or streams that on some recent sites, different towns, nonetheless, just as a comparison, 50 feet was considered a good, by an assessment, die-off period for the fecal coliform and nitrate levels to die off from a septic system and the plume underneath it. So 50 feet, maybe 80 feet in a very sandy soil. And these, of course, are a till. So I think that gives you any kind of a feel for what may happen with a single family system.
So the distance is so much here that we wouldn't see the effect at this point. Okay, that was my question.
I'd just like to add to that that in looking through the detail maps, just so we speed the process along a little bit, by ordinance, it says that there should be a test pit at each corner of the proposed leach field or chamber system, and one additional pit in that leach field. And I think, without being a stickler for detail, we're in a real critical area, and it simply is one way of looking. If we see the entire form, just one HHE 200 at all three pages, shows the profile of those test pits. One map shows that you have two pits, one on each corner. But we've got two more corners to go. And, it is in critical soils, critical area. I think it's for our own decision-making purposes, it's well worthwhile.
That has been done in accordance with on the HHE 200. The scale of the map wasn't able to
show
the cluster.
Yeah. Any other questions on the completeness? I really think this was good to get into some of these technical discussions. They are a little premature since we have agreed that this application is complete. The next step will be to have the site visit, and then we'll have the hearing, at which time we can get into many more of these technical details. Also, during this period of time, staff will go through this application and make additional comments, I would assume. If there is no other discussion on this issue, I would suggest that we next see you on the 13th on Saturday at 11 o'clock. Thank you. Thank you. Now we're back, still on our schedule. There are a couple of items that we would like to cover before we break for this evening. And one of them concerns an issue that we raised a number of months ago, which is now moved itself along to the point of some verbiage related to getting us out of the business of doing what we did tonight, and that is determining application completeness. But in the process of doing that, which I think is laudable, because I really think that this board has, frankly, better things to do than put applicants through this issue of a full meeting to determine the completeness. There are some legal aspects of this that have surfaced over the past few years based on certain subdivisions that came before review here where staff did determine application completeness and there was a problem that resulted. So we want to be careful that we don't get ourselves into more trouble by making this move. And there is a memo from our town attorney dated September 14th where this is discussed, and maybe you could give us a quick thumbnail sketch of the key issues involved here.
Sure.
Before we move ahead with this change to our procedures.
Okay. Apologize for the fact, you know, for your having to look at and try and digest a 4 or 5 page legal letter day of the meeting. What it does, though, is it follows and builds upon the language that was in my memo of September 12th and makes some changes in terms of wording. But for the most part, the town attorney, and this was the major issue that we talked about a little bit at the workshop, the major question was whether or not the town plan, in consultation with the planning board chairperson and vice chair, could, in essence, do most of the application completeness work. And last Tuesday, the question was, or the answer was unclear. Right now, after some work, the town attorney, in essence, has stated that, in a nutshell, that the way it's situated with just some minor changes, that can be done. The town planner, in consultation with two staff board members, can do that, at least in an initial sense.
Which is different than what happened a number of years ago, where it was strictly a staff member that made the determination, right?
Right. Yeah. Before, back when Gerald Daigle, who was the code enforcement officer at that time, was staffing the planning board, he was pretty much fulfilling some of the functions that I do now, and he was, in essence, kind of, you know, letting things come onto the agenda as enough materials came along. So, in a way, he was making some initial determinations regarding whether or not there's enough for the board to actually make some substantive decisions. There's nothing in the ordinance, however, that really gave him that authority. He was probably directed by the board to do that, but legally speaking, he wasn't authorized to do that, and that's what the court kind of caught upon a few years back. But as long as it's worded in the way that it is here, it can be done. So, Mr. Chairman, I don't know if what I can do is I can go through some of the suggested changes that the town attorney's made that would kind of highlight some of the changes from what I proposed. I'm not sure how you want to do it.
If you could paraphrase them, I think that would be good.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I don't know. I mean, we've got all night and spend till midnight if we want on this. This letter was on the table tonight from the town attorney, and we had all discussed and had seen the language that Steve had drafted before, and some of the same comments that the town attorney had, I think, some of us had about what's preliminary and what isn't. And just going through, just now quickly reading as you were discussing it, it appears as though all of the town attorney's suggestions are appropriate and are issues that make clarity out of our combined judgment at our meetings and then the drafting process. And Steve can certainly paraphrase the changes if you'd like him to, and maybe that should be done. Got a couple of specific questions that I wanted to ask even before that paraphrasing happened, so that maybe we can address that in the paraphrasing as well. Mm-hmm. One question relates to the issue of having the town planner preliminarily determine completeness or incompleteness, which is a point of clarity that the town attorney has made in his memo. But the other issue is whether or not the town planner has to go to the vice chairman and the chairman of the planning board both in order to do that preliminary application completeness. And I would submit that it should be either the chairman or the vice chairman if the chairman's not reachable. The bond between the planner and the chairman should always be very strong, and those two parties should, and the chairman is charged with determining the agenda for the town, mm-hmm. for the planning board.
Great.
That I would suggest that we not burden that process by having two people decide whether something's complete or incomplete preliminarily, since the planning board's still charged with that once it's brought to the agenda. So if Steve can address that. The second issue is what constitutes a pending application, as we've seen in some of our legal processes in the last couple of months on the planning board, over the last year in the planning board, there is an issue of what constitutes a pending application, and maybe Steve can address that and where we best define at what point an application pends before the town.
So the two issues would be whether it has to be chairperson or chairperson and vice chairman, and mm-hmm. what constitutes a pending application.
Yes.
I think as the first, I'll have to check with the town attorney's office. I don't think there would be a problem. I think the initial language was at one of the planning board members' suggestions. But I'll check and see if, I have a feeling that it can be chairman or vice chair if chairman's mm-hmm. not unavailable. What is a pending application, I think, is one of those issues that if you talk to three municipal attorneys, you get three different interpretations to a degree, although that's getting better. I think there still is a question as to if it's submitted to the town, but it's the board that's making the actual completeness determination. I think it's still unknown at this point as to whether or not it would take the board action, or if it would be, it'd be submittal to the town. And what this is trying to do is, it's trying to kind of have it both ways. Again, I have to confess, I don't know what the answer would be. I think attorneys could argue it either way.
Well, we're only concerned about one attorney, it's our town attorney, because he advises us. And I would think, Mr. Chairman, that that's a question, before we send it to the town council, it may need to be resolved that if we have a fairly lengthy and substantive staff review, which we could have over a period of time, like other towns and cities do, that may constitute a substantive review. And that question, that word is always used by our attorney in wondering whether something's pending or not, whether it's received a substantive review by the town. And he's never defined whether that's the planning board or the staff. But it looks like we're moving more into a substantive review by the staff before it even gets to the agenda of the town planning board. I'd like to see it, if we can clearly define it as a matter in the language that we send to the town council, that will resolve once and for all when it is a pending application.
I think that would have been helpful in at least two cases that I know of in the last year.
Yep.
Where we were questioned on that point. I guess we have one area of uncertainty in terms of what is a pending application. Any other comments?
On that issue, I think, and as you mentioned, I was just reviewing down through page 3 where our town attorney took out the word pending. Yep. To avoid that issue.
Yep.
I agree with you, and I don't know whether it requires that we start defining certain terms as part of the ordinance, but there's nothing wrong with doing that, right in the ordinance, define pending application, define substantive review in reasonable detail. And your point is well taken. We are only concerned at this point in time about one
right.
Legal opinion. That's our own municipal attorney.
I will definitely ask Tom Leahy's office for an opinion. I think why it was suggested be taken out is that it probably doesn't matter whether you state it or not. I mean, you can signify the town's intent, but when it came right down to it, if something was brought to court, I think the town attorney's feeling is that whether or not it's stated as such or not, you know, the town perhaps could argue it earlier or later. So, but I'll find out. I'll see if we can clarify it. Identify the point in time at which it becomes a pending application, see if we can have some language that makes it clear so nobody has to guess.
It's one of those draw a line in the sand type thing. There, that's pending. Nope, step over it.
They don't draw lines in sand anymore. I would suggest, Mr. Chairman, that the issue becomes a pending application once the town planner has picked it up and begins to review it, not for completeness, not to do the checklist thing of whether everything's there, but at the point where the engineers are looking at it, the department heads are looking at it in a substantive review matter, when it's begun to receive that review.
The application is deemed to be complete, and it's starting through the process, is what you're saying.
Yes.
Yeah. I agree. Because so really, for all intents and purposes, until it's deemed to be complete, there's nothing to look at from the way we've looked at it until now.
Although in the past, and you have one item before you where one item this evening where there was some substantive discussion at a workshop before completeness was determined.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think the way it's proposed, that wouldn't happen. I mean, what would happen is you would have a pre-application conference where they come in, generally state what's being proposed, general level of comments by the planning board, then it goes off, and then the applicants would work with the town planner, who would then consult with the planning board chairman, and then once the major details were taken care of, then it would come back for the board in an official manner.
Yeah.
But even that kind of the pre-application conference that the town has, even that raises some potential problems with respect to what constitutes a pending application.
It seems to me that the starting point has to be the point where the applicant says, here's what I'm submitting, check it over for completeness. I think the pre-application conference is a time when, at least the ones that we've had that I'm familiar with, it's where the applicant comes in and sounds us out on various issues. It's very possible that the applicant could go away for a year or more after that. And so I have a hard time considering that part of substantive review. I really do. I think that the commitment really comes after, in my own opinion, commitment comes after that application is accepted as complete and we start into spending town dollars in reviewing the application, to put it in financial terms. So that's where I'd like to see the substantive review point start. That's my own personal opinion. Otherwise, we could be in a position of calling a lot of tentative-type proposals in review, and there's really no good purpose in this area.
Could I?
Oops, go ahead.
Sorry, Mr. Chairman.
Please.
I guess I've become unclear listening to the two of you at just which point you're talking. I thought at first that Dick was talking about the application being pending before the application completeness. Is that right?
Well, there may be debate, and I'm sure there would be in a court of law about when something was pending, and there has been in the past. I think my only point early on was that when we've now charged the town planner with the preliminary application completeness determination still coming before the board, then that's an issue of a substance. And when you have a process that is split up between preliminary completeness review, scheduling for some subsequent planning board meeting, which may be months away, depending on agendas, like in South Portland, where agendas have been very crowded. And you have a review process that has now started with engineers, department heads in the town, and others doing review processes, even before perhaps the planning board has made a determination of completeness, that there may be some substantive review process that has occurred. And then there's always the question of the town planner's preliminary determination of completeness. Does that constitute substantive review or pending application, even though the board hasn't voted? I think the question is that, given those issues, what does our attorney say about pending applications? And maybe as much for definition in the ordinance, if we can, or at least edification for the board members of when an application is pending. And that really only becomes important when you're changing ordinances, as we've done with the wetlands ordinance, and which ordinance are people under, given when they started or had a substantive review. And that's generally the only time you start seeing people talking about when something was pending or not, what set of rules they're under.
But that's the time we want to flip to the, so to the ordinances have something there that we can sink our teeth into. I think what's happening here is we're wrestling for some guidance, and I think that we're looking for that guidance from our attorney.
Certainly, some solidification of what I think we're all thinking. And for me, if an applicant comes in and has spent the money for the application fee and for some engineering work and for some legal work and what have you, and comes in seriously and expects to be taken seriously, even if it is at the preliminary or initial stage for application completion, and his proposal is taken seriously and we deal with him from a serious, then for as far as I'm concerned, it's pending. It doesn't need an imprimatur or of some type. I mean, he thinks that we're taking him serious. But again, that's very vague.
But the state law makes a distinction between technical review, which is, okay, tell us about your project and let's see what information you have, versus substantive. Here's what we as a board think about what you're proposing in terms of number of units, your stormwater, your open space preservation. And the courts, you know, the law states that you can draw the line. Somebody can submit it.
whole package of information. If the board looks at it and says, we just looked at a check, as you do now, mm-hmm. we looked at the checklist, we don't want to get any details, we're just doing completeness, you're lacking five items, come back next month.
Literally, the way I look at it, the applicant presents us something. We look at it, it's not complete. Literally, we say, here it is back. Well, we don't really do that. But in mm-hmm. essence, we're saying, here it is back, fix it, give it back to us. Then when we finally accept it, we say, okay, now we'll open rubber bands and we'll look at it. That's probably a simple oversimplification, but that's the way I look at application completeness. Now, indeed, for Steve to make that determination, he's looked through the packet, and so are we, and all that, and that's going on. But in a sense of procedure, we don't open those rubber bands until the application is deemed complete.
I think what Mr. Tinsman's raising is a more detailed discussion, because at the staff level, I have lots mm-hmm. of discussions, detail to go beyond completeness in many cases. By shifting the added responsibility authority over to the town planner, does that staff planner then become limited in what he or she can say? Mm. In terms of complaining, more mm-hmm. more triggering mm-hmm. substance. So I think this all is something really needs to be looked at and brought back and made clear to everybody. Because I think it may, if this goes through, it may dictate how much the staff planner can say at mm-hmm. a certain point in the review process.
Yeah. And this is timely too, given what's going on in terms of town personnel action right now. I'd like to make a suggestion. I don't know whether we have to go formally with a motion. Maybe we should do this, but I'd like to remand this back to Steve and Tom Leahy to clarify these points for us, draft some language that satisfies the questions we have at hand here, and bring it before us at our next meeting so we could possibly take some action on this and send it up to the town council in a form that we can live with.
So that'll give us the time to review the town attorney's
right.
Response to.
Is this acceptable to the rest of the board?
It's fine for me.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
I have one question.
Sure.
Since Steve is going to be talking to the attorney, can what we can say and not say at a pre-application conference be clarified so we do not make an early, even non-application, a pending one? I've seen that happen in other communities just by what questions were brought up. And I don't know if we can only listen to the proposal or to what extent we can discuss it and give the applicants guidance.
Okay. Right. We'll still have pre-applications. We just won't have the application completeness review part on our agenda. But we'll still have pre-applications, and that's a good point.
But I think the question may be, Judith was saying, perhaps, if you're going to have the board perhaps shouldn't be really constrained in terms of how much it gets in the substance during pre-application, as long as it knows that if it crosses over a certain line, it may become pending if that's an issue. That's the sort of, I think, discussion we heard Judy asking.
We'd like to know what that line is, though.
Yeah, exactly. No lines in sand.
Right, no lines in sand. Any other points on this? Okay, fine. Last item, there's one minor item that I'd like to just bring up before we go to the last item that Steve wants to discuss with us, which goes back to our last meeting, is the date of our November meeting, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Just want people to be aware of the fact that the third Tuesday in November falls on the Tuesday before Thanksgiving. And I'm just making that statement. If that is a problem for a majority of the planning board members, we can change our regular meeting. It doesn't happen to be a problem for me. No? Okay, then we will stand as the calendar is read.
Not yet, anyway.
Huh?
Not yet, is it a
Not
problem?
Yet, okay. Well, we're giving you 2 months' notice. Okay, the last item is on the Zorsky application, and there is a letter here from Steve, which we got tonight.
Have we seen that, Mr. Chairman?
No. Actually, Zorsky Thibodeau, I could just give a brief brief update. That's actually something that doesn't have to be discussed with the whole board. The other item was more issue about the Highlands and the Normandot Associates discussion.
Okay,
although we can talk about the Zorsky Thibodeau.
I took the wrong item.
Okay. In a nutshell, I'm just looking for a little bit of guidance from the board. Way back in the spring, there Normando Associates was hired by the town. Betsy Day is a staff person, was hired by the town to review some of the wetlands work that was done by the Highlands at Broad Cove project, and on and on. And it turns out the neighbors hired their own wetlands expert and so on. What happened in a nutshell was that the Normando recommendation in terms of where the wetlands boundaries were agreed to by the applicant, Peter Kennedy. And they were kind of they're conservatively drawn on the side of adding any questionable. If there are any questionable areas, it was considered to be a wetland. That was all fine and good. Everybody was saying, though, that to confirm the actual location boundaries of the wetlands, a final wetlands analysis should be done later on, and when weather permitted. We were back when this is coming up. The ground was frozen. There's probably 1 or 2 feet of snow over it. The ground is not frozen now. Everything's fine. One of the conditions of your wetlands alteration approval was that the Normando go out and do that final site analysis. However, I think it was 2 workshops ago when we were talking before with Peter Kennedy about some of his different proposed changes. The question came up in terms of whether or not there was still a need to do that at this point, or was the town satisfied? Was the applicant satisfied? Were even the neighbor satisfied that the existing boundaries were kind of the maximum situation? And having talked with somebody else in the Normando office, they feel comfortable as the town's wetlands consultant in terms of where the current boundaries are. So all this leads down to the question in terms of whether or not there's a need to have that condition complied with in terms of having Normando go out, do another review of the site, or if it makes sense, since everybody seems to be in agreement that this happened, that this come back and that condition be removed from the wetlands alteration approval. So that's the first issue. What action should be taken? Second issue is, when should this occur? Logically, it makes sense to have it occur when the Highlands of Broad Cove comes back with their final plan, and you can start up again and everything else. However, the problem may be that they may come back when the ground is frozen. Again, there's a foot or two of snow. We may be in the same problem that we were January, February of this past year. So the two issues: one, what's your general sense as a planning board, and then two, when should things be done if the idea is to perhaps not go through that final step and incur the additional cost?
When Steve raised this issue with me earlier today, my comment was that we should wait until the applicant comes back with his final plan approval, at which time that would be on our agenda. This issue should be raised at that time, since then the people involved will have the opportunity to be here if they want to, or at least watch it and on cable. And if that issue wants to get raised at that time, it gets raised. If it happens to be at that time the ground is frozen, well, that's the way it happens to be. I think taking it on at this point in time with no advance notice to anybody could be construed to be not in the best interest of the parties that were involved. And that was my suggestion to Steve, but I'm open to other planning board suggestions on the same.
It appears that the only thing that we shouldn't do is not do anything with it. We've got two options, with numerous options, but number one, we could state that Normando's confirmation of the existing lines as per the plan are acceptable as a substitute, whatever the correct verbiage is, or strike the requirement from the earlier record. Sorry?
Right.
Or a combination of the two.
Or a combination of the two. Number three, when do we do that?
Right.
To myself, it makes sense the date that they come back. It's the third alternative that we hire Norman Doe to go back out and actually physically map it, that would be held up by weather considerations. They've already stated that they consider where it is to be sufficient. I think it's the least likely option that we'd be forced by weather or climate or frozen ground to delay any decision. So I would recommend that we make the decision the first meeting that they come back, make it a part of the public record that we choose one or two or a combination of one and two as options.
Okay. Any other suggestions?
Mr. Chairman, I don't have any suggestion, but only a comment on why I'm being so quiet. I may have been pulled out of any decision process for Highlands. I understand my brother may be marketing properties down there. I don't know that for sure, but if that is the case, then I would not be participating in any decisions in the Highlands project. I only heard that as a rumor this morning from another brother, so I don't know that that's the case.
You talk to your brothers, right?
That's good. Christmas, Thanksgiving, and Easter.
Okay. Any other comments on this issue? You have the guidance that you need on this, Steve?
I guess what I'm hearing is we'll hold off. We won't have them to go out, and decision will be made by the board when it comes back before you, whenever, shape, or form.
That's a thought.
Okay.
Any other items to come before the full board at this point?
Well, there's a briefing that you were going to give us on the two lights application.
It was just an update in terms of where things stood. In terms of the follow-through and some of the conditions. And if anything, I think what we have to do is go back, and I want to make sure we all know what the conditions are. But just one update is that there was a request that the sign be moved.
Speed limit sign.
Sorry, speed limit sign, right, in that area. Good distinction to make. Speed limit sign be moved closer to the Two Lights State Park entrance. And that, as it turns out, is something that can be done, and we're in the midst of having that worked out. So in the next month or two, that'll be moved. So it'll give more time. It'll be moved in both directions. So cars coming up from the Lobster Shack area and heading out I guess it would be a westerly direction on Two Lights Road will supposedly be staying at the 25-mile-per-hour posted speed till a good distance past Beacon Lane entrance point, and conversely, they'll hopefully be decelerating sooner from 35 down to 25. So by the time they get to that point, they'll be traveling at lesser speed. So.
But this would not change any of the conditions that we went under. I mean, I really feel that, anything can happen after we make an application approval, and I think they are looking at a 350-foot sight distance, no matter what, as far as I can see.
Right.
Mr. Chairman, they told us they could achieve 350, and the conditions of the approval were right to achieve the 350.
Right. And now, there's some, we're working through the conditions. I think they're amenable to meeting the letter and the intent of the conditions. One of the suggestions was to go before the town engineer, that they prepare a plan. That the plan and the applicant's engineer's letter be reviewed by the town engineer. That was done. The town engineer has had some comments, and so we're now working through that stage. So it's kind of more an update in terms of where things stand.
But I guess from my perspective, there should be nothing that takes precedence over the conditions that we put on this approval. And I'm saying that very clearly. I mean, if the town engineer says 350 is not necessary, and in other words, there's nothing that can go on in this review process that takes back what we've put on to
right.
This. Okay.
No,
so I understand
the issue is more how the site distance is measured.
Okay.
You know, and is it to get into? I mean, it's murky. If you remember, you went from the public access waiver standards to the subdivision standards, but then you start waiving some of those standards, which you're allowed to do. It's a complicated process. Well, it turns out there's two different ways of measuring site distance. There's one way in the public access waiver standards. There's another method, slightly different, in the subdivision standards. So, you know, it's little questions like this that haven't worked out. I mean, I think we'll come up with an end result, but it wasn't the easiest set of conditions to, one, understand, and secondly, have followed through on by all sides.
We'd appreciate being kept up to date on how this is being complied with.
Okay.
Good. Any other items to come before the board at this point in time? Do I hear a motion?
Will we adjourn?
Second the motion.
Thank you very much. Have a very good evening.
Okay.
All those in favor.